So we have Budajan. He's one of the KDE system administrators, and he's going to talk about all those things that system administrators do, which I have no idea because I'm not one. So let's give him a warm welcome. Thank you.
Guten Tag. I think that's how you say good afternoon in German. All right. So have you tried turning it off and on again? If any one of you have ever watched the IT Crowd, you know what I'm talking about. So yeah, this is, it's not quick. It's an hour-long presentation, but it's a look at what IT is up to in KDE. So this talk was supposed to be, a Dwe talk with me and Nicholas, but Nicholas is still in Argentina, so it'll just be me. Hang on. Right. So yeah, who am I? My name is Bodhayan Gupta. I'm a fairly recent member in KDE. I started developing about 1.8 years ago, but I've slowly gravitated towards being a sysadmin. And I'm still an undergraduate student, so I'll be I still have a year to go and like get my degree. So what do we have on today's menu? Interesting. This is actually not all of it. There's so much stuff that we are doing, and we want to tell you that this is majorly what we are going to be talking about. So I'll take you through the kind of servers that we have. It's not a comprehensive server inventory, but you'll get an idea of the kind of hardware we operate on. There's Fabricator migration. Fabricator is, we're trying to use Fabricator to replace a whole bunch of tools, and we'll talk about the progress of that migration and where we need help, what kind of bugs and idiosyncrasies are that we are dealing with. KDEprojects.xml, it's a XML file that has metadata about KDE projects that at least continuous integration and KDE SRC build, they use to automatically build and test stuff. So that had to be retired and replaced last year, so I'll talk about that because we want to take that forward and create bigger things from that. And we've had a couple of new services since last year. We are currently mirroring all our mainline repositories on GitHub, read-only mirrors only. And we sync all our messages between Telegram and IRC, so I'll talk about those. Propagator is it's KDE's first server software. So we are building it in-house to scratch our own itches, and we're probably going to be releasing it as a standalone product for other people to use if they find it useful. So there's a major section of this presentation is about Propagator. And we have got a couple of new sponsors who sponsor technology for us. It's not monetary sponsorship, but they provide services to us, so we'll talk about those. Let's start. So we'll start with server inventory. Again, this is not comprehensive. There's way too many. There's like 50 different servers spread across multiple platforms, so I won't give you a comprehensive overview. So here's what we do. We have we don't own any servers. There's no servers that KDEV pays for. We don't own anything. We either rent servers, that's what we pay for, or people have donated machines to us that we, find data centers to co-locate with. Again, those data centers are sponsoring the co-location for us. And we have some completely sponsored servers, so we have private individuals who donate us capacity on their personal servers, or there are companies which donate some server space or even an actual server or KVM machine to us. And machine types. So most of the machines that we rent or are donated are hugely powerful machines that run as physical hosts for other LXC containers. We split them up into smaller containers with LXC and we use a bunch of KVM virtual machines. There are some companies that donate KVM instances to us. We use DigitalOcean. That's just KVM. We'll talk about that later. And there's something about, like, the machines are all either in continental Europe or the United States of America. So this is something that we're going to have to change because there's not enough geographical spread of the servers. So that's another thing that we're working towards. Okay, so let's get started with some important service. So AnonGit, the anonymous read-only Git network, it's this only two servers that run the AnonGit network. One is Mason, that's in Switzerland. It's a KVM instance with 4 GB of RAM, 100 GB of hard drive space, and one CPU core. It's donated by Stepping Stone of Switzerland. It runs Debian, so all our repositories taken together are around 75 GB, so 100 GB of disk space is enough. This is only the Git repositories. The SVN is another 90 GB or so. Okay, and Erisid is one of our newer servers. It's in San Francisco. It's a KVM instance it's a droplet with 1 GB of RAM and 30 GB of disk space. We have a 100 GB DigitalOcean block storage device attached to it to host the repositories. Similar stuff for Anon SVN. So Elder is another droplet, same thing. Instead of 100 GB disk, it has 120 GB disk because the SVN repositories are just hugely large. IRC services run on a server called Spring, and that's an LXC host on a physical host called Goma. Now, this is what our typical physical host looks like. It's 32 GB of RAM and 8-core i7 at 3 GHz, and it has a 2 terabyte spinning Rust hard drive. Again, rented from Hetzner. We rent almost all our machines from Hetzner. And this is actually our most powerful server ever. We just bought this year. It's called Recluse. We rented it from Hetzner. It has 64 GB of RAM and two 500 GB SSDs that are mirrored. So we trust ZFS on Linux with mission-critical data. ZFS is the file system that came out with OpenSolaris and then got adopted by FreeBSD. So yeah, the Lawrence, if you've heard of it, Lawrence Livermore National Laboratory in the US has been running a project to port ZFS to Linux. And we trust them with this mission-critical data. We have had, the resilience features that ZFS provides us is, we use, so ZFS has built-in mirroring, built-in special RAID stuff, and we feel safer trusting ZFS on Linux with all of this data rather than, say, a solution based around MD and LVM and EXT4. And yeah, 8-core i7, 3 GHz processor, and it's currently underused because we only have code repositories and we're planning to move Fabricated to it. So yeah, we can, capacity is not a problem here. We can expand this server into other roles. Yeah, and so this brings us to our next topic, which is Fabricated migration. So sometime during the last year, before last Academy, KDE as a whole, the community decided that we are going to replace a whole bunch of tools with Fabricated. It's one tool to do project management and a lot of task boards, ticketing, a lot of stuff. And if you've ever seen Fabricated's website or our own Fabricated instance, their error messages, it actually tries really hard to bring some humor into the process here. So yeah, that's a 404 page. Yeah. So what do we use Fabricated for? So it replaces a whole bunch of things. Repo hosting and browsing. So we use Gitalite to have access control on our repositories, who gets to write to what, who gets to read to what, and Quick Git to browse the repositories. So this is all going to be replaced by Fabricated's Diffusion app. So it's going to handle access control and repository browsing by itself. Project management. We had Chili project, which we killed off, so we actually don't have a project management tool at all right now. So Fabricator projects are currently free to switch to Fabricator if they want, and a whole bunch of projects have actually switched to Fabricator for project management. Workboards. We have a tool called Canboard, which we use to have Kanban boards, task boards for workboards for people or projects. But again, we have seen a whole bunch of projects just move wholesale to Fabricator just because it's so much integrated and it's apparently easier to use. Etherpad, to a certain extent, is being replaced by Fabricator's workboards. It's also going to some, if people are using Etherpad to create documents, Etherpad is going to go away. So the two replacements for it are going to be OwnCloud or NextCloud, documents in OwnCloud or NextCloud, or Canboard, sorry, Fabricator Workboards for workboard kind of stuff. So yeah, code review. Review board, the code review tool that we currently use, is also going to be replaced by Fabricator. The new tool is called Differential in Fabricator. Again, Plasma has been using it for a long time now, and they're really happy with it. Sysadmin tickets, we have already actually done this. We have shut down Trellis. We are only accepting tickets on Fabricator. And possibly KDE identity, because identity is going away. It's a huge pain in the neck to operate. And one of the things that we are looking at to replace identity with is Fabricator as an OAuth provider. So yeah, Fabricator replaces a lot of apps and reduces the maintenance headache because it's just one app to maintain now. But again, if you're putting so many things in, so many eggs in one basket, it becomes a single point of failure. So if Fabricator goes down, this is the downside of all of this. If Fabricator goes down, then a whole bunch of services also go down with it. So we are actually Fabricator has something to mitigate that. They actually have built-in clustering support. But again, that's another pain in the neck to configure. So that it'll probably be a while before we have clustering running. But that's, again, on the long-term list. So what's our migration plan? So we started by installing a test instance of Fabricator that was provided on a server on Jeff Mitchell's personal server. Jeff is one of our long-time sysadmins. So the current Fabricator that's running is actually on Jeff's personal server. So we are trying to move it to Recluse. Then what we did was import a few test projects and let them evaluate how well it works. So in the end, all of Plasma ended up migrating to Fabricator, and they're apparently very happy with it, how it works. The downside of this is that there's way too much data, so we can't start over. We'll actually have to migrate the database from the old machine to the new machine. Okay, so the next step was to shut down Trellis and use Fabricator to accept sysadmin tickets. That's also done, and it had another effect that it forced a lot of people who were not using Fabricator to create Fabricator accounts now, just to be able to file tickets. So we now have a lot more of the user base on Fabricator than we did before. The next step is to transfer Fabricator to the new machine, to Recluse. And for the last 6 hours, Ben has been asking me to do this, but I'm just too tired to do this now. I'll probably get this done later today or sometime tomorrow evening. But yeah, so this is what's going to be done in the next this weekend or so. So what next? After that, we'll have to get all the repositories and all the projects imported to Fabricator. So we only have we have all the Plasma projects on Fabricator and a few other projects, but if we'll have to get everything transferred over to the to Fabricator, and this is going to be a mammoth task. This is not something that the sysadmins can do on our own. So project maintainers have to step up and transfer their own projects. We'll tell you how, but every project maintainer has to step up and do this now. Start using Fabricator to host repos. So upstream needs to change a couple of things before this can happen. And I'm going to, in a later slide, I'm going to explain this. And we'll have to adapt Propagator to handle Fabricator's way of handling repos. And I'm going to be, again, talking about Propagator at a later stage, and you'll realize what that involves. And once we're done using, we are done setting up Fabricator for everything. Yeah, I know. I have a counter running here. Once we are done completing our primary migration to Fabricator, all our repositories are there. Everyone's using it for project management. We kill identity and probably try to use Fabricator as a single sign-on provider. So, what are the effects so far? So, users of Fabricator are happy. Plasma uses it for almost everything. I am a maintainer of one tool, the screenshot tool. I also use it for workboard and stuff, and I find it a lot easier to manage things. So the downside of this is that, again, there's a lot of data. There's so much data that people have put into it that migrating it is starting to become a hassle. But we'll have to migrate it. We can't start afresh. And upstream collaborates well with us. We have reported a couple of bugs and they have been fixed in time, and again, and we are conversing with them about features and workflows that we want. And they're not completely, I mean, they're actually receptive to our ideas and our needs, and it's not, they're not stonewalling us or anything. It's actually pretty, it's going well. And sysadmin tickets have become easier to manage, so yeah. So with Trellis, the old system, the problem that we had was that tickets could only be private. They could only be seen by the person who filed the ticket and the system administrators. This is with Fabricator, we can choose to make a ticket public. So people, so if someone files a ticket about a big infrastructural change, others can also weigh in on that ticket and provide their opinion or their agenda, things that they'd want taken care of on that topic, and so on and so forth. And Trellis was over-organized. We had like 17 categories for 10 tickets a day. So yeah, that over-organization is now gone. It's just, we actually have these tickets, they're tasks. So we create these tasks, they end up on a workboard, which we can just arrange by column. We can just move things over from one column to another, depending on priority and so on and so forth. So it's just reduced our overhead by quite a bit. So yeah, so where do we need help? So with Fabricator, we are creating this new concept called the community administrator. A community administrator is sort of someone between a system administrator and a developer. So a community administrator will have some permissions. They can create repos, they can move projects around, create sub-projects and so on. They can also set permissions. So we have a few community admins who, the administration workload of Fabricator is shared with them, but we'll be really happy if you step up to be a community admin, if other people step up to be a community admin, because we can use all the help that we can get there. And data migration. Data migration is the biggest headache that we're dealing with right now with Fabricator. So Trellis, our old sysadmin ticket system, has been shut down, but we still have to keep our records. We'll have to migrate all of the data over into Fabricator. Canboard, our old workboard, that again has to be migrated to Fabricator. And repository imports. So again, this is where we need a lot of help with, especially Trellis and Canboard. We'll need someone to look at SQL database dump, figure out the schema, get the data, and then use Fabricator's Conduit API to upload it all to Fabricator. So it's a lot of scripting and work, and we need some help there. Repo import, it's a lot of manual work, but again, yeah, manual work. So here's a couple of idiosyncrasies that we have to solve before we can get Fabricator fully up and running. So Diffusion is the Fabricator's repository hosting app. They have numbers in the clone URL. This is a typical clone URL: SSH git fabricator.kde.org /191/websites.kde. That's actually supposed to be, it's a spaced repo, namespace repo, so it should actually be website slash www.kd-kd-org.git, but it converts the hyphen, the slash to a hyphen. So it's things like these that we have to get sorted with upstream before we can have, you can start. So yeah, so you can either have numbers, or if you can give call signs, if you assign a call sign to a repository, you can actually use the call sign. But then the call sign has to be all caps. So yeah, that also looks really ugly. Although it's probably better than having numbers, but it just looks ugly. MediaWiki logins randomly fail against Fabricator's OAuth provider and for certain people only. So we are having a hard time debugging that. And Diffusion stores repos on disk with those numbers. So even if you have a call sign on disk inside the directory where all the repositories are stored, it's going to be stored in a folder called 191.git. So we'll have to tap into Fabricator's Conduit API to figure out what 191 is before we know which repository it actually corresponds to. Or you can manually run git log, but who does that? It's not an option in when you're writing scripts that deal with repositories directly. Okay, this wasn't on the agenda, but yeah, this is important enough that and Olivier asked for this. So I'm going to discuss this now. So KD identity is our single sign-on system. You create a KD identity account, you have access to all the apps, Fabricator, Review Board, Canboard, Notes, OwnCloud, etc. So it's based around Open LDAP, which doesn't scale at all, and it's incredibly buggy. And it's a custom web front end called Solina that was written by Ben, and it's written in PHP and the E framework. Again, it doesn't scale at all. So LDAP itself, the protocol, the way it's designed, it works really well for a user and group database, but Open LDAP as a software does not. Again, web front end works well for the UI. I mean, we want a web front end, but then PHP and E do not. So we have what we want, but the tools that we use to build it are aging. We'll have to replace it at some point. And the other thing that we're trying to do is that we're having a problem with is spam fighting. So spam is a major problem. We have wiki pages, tasks on Fabricator, and entries in Bugzilla that are filed with spam, like just random phone numbers of call centers and things. Not only is that, is it annoying at some point? We have actually gotten a whole bunch of lawyers contacting us saying that we are violating trademarks because we have all these things on our website, which is actually spam. So so we have to stop that. So and except for Bugzilla. Bugzilla is the one tool that's not integrated with KD identity. So all except Bugzilla need KD identity accounts. So if we can stop spammers from signing up into identity, we can actually stop the people from spamming. So we have had to do that, but unfortunately the current method is too crude. Entire ISPs, entire IP blocks are now blocked by us. A lot of Indian ISPs, some Japanese ISPs, Linode, DigitalOcean, VPS providers, they're just blocked wholesale because a lot of spam has been coming through them. So these people now have to email sysadmin if they want an account. So we'll have to change that because we can't just block people wholesale. So a potential goal for solutions would be and this is assuming that we don't use Fabricator as the SSO, we use another custom solution based around LDAP. So Fedora Directory Services or 389DS will be used to replace Open LDAP. We'll provide OpenID and OAuth in addition to LDAP. So a lot of apps, MediaWiki, for example, they work better with OAuth than with LDAP. So we'll just use the database to provide our own OAuth provider. And LDAP groups, the permission groups, they translate well to OAuth scopes. And OpenID also has scopes. So we can actually have the same fine-grained permissions that we have with LDAP with OAuth and OpenID. We ideally want to move to a solution based completely around OAuth, but we can't. There are certain tools, including our mail servers, for example, that won't talk to. It's not a trivial task trying to get them to talk to OAuth because OAuth was based around web HTTP. And we need those people, those tools, email servers and Jabber, for example. They need something that can talk to an authentication server with a protocol that's based only that's built for authentication. Okay, so and to combat spam, we'll probably need a probabilistic model to detect spammers. So we take. Which ISP are you on? What is your IP? Is it on any spam database? Which OS are you running? More people are likely to sign up for us who are running Linux than people running Mac or Windows. So that could be a weightage factor. Have they signed up in the recent past? Do they already have an account? Are they trying to create a duplicate account? So we could try to identify the browser through, and that has privacy implications, but. If we can actually do it, we can get another factor to weigh against. And so we get all of these factors, and then we do Bayesian filtering, fixed weights for all of these factors, and then we run some math, and then we figure out it on a scale of 0 to 1 how likely they are to be a spammer, and then probably divide them into 3 queues, a green queue, so yeah, your account can be created. In yellow queue, okay, you look slightly dodgy. We are going to manually approve your account. And red, so you're definitely a spammer. You're not getting there. Not on the slides. We have been in talks with people at Fedora Infrastructure. They actually have built a tool that does something like this called Basset. And we may have use for Basset in doing the probabilistic spam detection. So again, it's just tools that we have to bring together to build a solution. OK, so now KDE_projects.xml replacement. What is KDE_projects.xml? So this is the URL at which you can access this file. So we used to have Redmine for managing our projects way back. And then some political situation ended up, people ended up forking Redmine to a new tool called Chili Project. And we started to use it. And then Chili Project died. And at that point, Chili Project had changed enough that migrating back to Redmine wasn't a practical solution at all. So Chili Project died, no path to migrate back, security bugs that weren't being fixed. Our Chili Project server started to go down every time Google tried to index it because it just way too much server load. So yeah, oops, we had to kill it without a complete replacement. But there was this one part of the project infrastructure that we couldn't kill, the KDE project's XML file, because Scarlett and Michael, these two people would have had our heads the moment we, I know, you're there. Yeah. Oh, excellent. So that's just one person to worry about now. But oops. So that's back.
Translation infrastructure as well.
Oh, right. Yeah, I had to get your approval before changing the files. Right, I forgot. I'll add the name there. So descriptions, repo paths, a list of maintainers, and yeah, used at least by, I mean, off the top of my head, I could only think of CI and KDE as I see, but now you know, yeah. Plasma, build infrastructure, and translations all use this file to figure out metadata for projects. So we had to keep this around. So how did we replace it? This is the first stage, and this has been done. So without Chili Project as a database for project, we needed a data source. So what we did was we took the last available KDE projects file and then ran a bunch of scripts to convert it into a directory structure represented in the file system. And the project hierarchy itself is represented in the file system. And inside every directory, there's a YML file that describes the metadata for that project, the name, the description, the maintainers, whether the repo is active, the path to the repo, and so on. A separate JSON file describes the I18N branches for every project. And a Python script then does the entire work in reverse. It reads all of those YML files and generates the XML file. It runs every 30 minutes, so it isn't live. The previous version actually had to be the file was generated every time someone made a request to that URL, but this time, but now it's cached for 30 minutes, but it's way faster. Even the live generation with Chili Project used to take at least 15 seconds to generate the entire file and then download it back to the user, so it wasn't a very fast solution. With the new Python solution, on the server that we're running it on, Mason. Yeah, we're running it on Mason. So it isn't a very powerful server, as you saw. It was only a KVM instance with 100 GB of disk space. And yeah, spinning Rust hard drive. But it actually does the work in less than 3 seconds. It generates the file in less than 3 seconds, running through thousands of subdirectories. And we do this every 30 minutes. So this is what has been done. So this is, OK, this should actually have been replaced the front end. So this is on our long-term to-do list. We want to replace the XML file with a RESTful JSON API service. So basically, a rough cut of the API is available at apps.kde.org/API, and documentation is available here, but this is subject to change. This is something that I've just been hacking on in my spare time. And the idea here is that you don't have to download the entire 1.8 megabyte KDE projects.xml every time you want to make some changes. You just make an API call to mentioning whatever project you want to access in the URL, and only the relevant chunk of data is returned to you as JSON file. So this is going to need changes in KDE SRC build. If we end up deprecating the XML file, it's going to need changes in translation, so on and so forth. So yeah, I'm going to, we'd like to hear some comments about how well this is going to work out for the different teams if we go end up doing this. And step three, this is, I mean, once we've created an API service, we'd like to be able to use the API service to have to generate the kde.org/applications sub website, because that website is outdated and we have data in two places. We have some data in the website itself, and we have some data in the project metadata repository. And we'd like to have all the data in the project metadata repository, and this website should just use that data to generate pages for the applications. So the new plan is to get data from the API service, get more data from AppStream metadata, because that has a lot of that has screenshots, icons, translated human readable names, and translated descriptions, and so on. So we want to use that metadata, and we want to use all of that data to generate the dynamics, to generate a dynamic site from those sources. So we won't have any outdated web pages, because once someone updates the AppStream metadata, we have an updated website. So we'll have to coordinate that with the, there's going to be a new kde.org website. Olivier is working on this. So we are going to be, we need to work out a solution on how this can happen. And finally, once Fabricator becomes our thing for everything, there may be no need to keep the KDE metadata repository around anymore. So then the Fabricator API conduit becomes our data store again. So that's how the KDE projects.xml file is going to work out. Okay, new services. We now do GitHub mirroring, courtesy of a mail sent in by Martin that started off a huge discussion, over 140 mails spread across three mailing lists, way too much bike shedding. But then eventually we settled on a plan to create a read-only mirroring system. No issues, tasks, or pull requests, we were going to ignore them altogether. There's no realistic way we can manage data in two places. So all the development happens on KDE servers, on KDE infrastructure, but we have our repositories on GitHub. So whatever, as long as you make commits to the KDE repositories with the same email ID that is associated with your GitHub account, the contributions show up on your GitHub profile. So it adds to your GitHub profile. You get discovered by potential employers. And we get to rely on GitHub in case our anon git mirror goes down, so the code's always available. And currently, it's synced real time from code.kde.org, so the moment you make a push to git.kde.org, the new commits are pushed out to GitHub immediately. But GitHub's git ref systems are interesting. So on push, it only accepts tag and head refs. And we actually do use a couple of custom refs for backups of the repository, so we can't push those. So we can't do a git push -- mirror there. So and on the GitHub server side, they also have custom refs. All pull requests end up being a ref. So we don't want to have that affect our mirror push infrastructure. So what we do is we can't do git push mirror. So we do a git push mirror, but we actually use the dummy flag with it. So we use that to get a list of all the refs that are going to be changed. Then we filter that list of refs and only push the updated head and tag refs. So it's a two-step process, but it works fine. So I don't think there's any need to change that. All right. The other service that we have started is Telegram Sync. So KDE only maintains IRC as the KDE sysadmin only maintains IRC as the official communication channel. Whatever happens there has some, we consider it to be official, so we can actually refer to it as proof of conversation happening around something. but people ended up talking on Telegram anyway. So it's an app, it's the cool thing. It has mobile support. They claim they're secure, but I don't know how that matters here. And it's actually way more convenient. That's the killer deal here. That's the deal maker here. It's Telegram is just way more convenient. So people end up using Telegram for practical reasons, and we want IRC as our official communication channels for reasons. And so we decided, let's just not treat them as second-class citizens. Let's just bridge the two. So anything talked about on IRC appears on the Telegram group and vice versa. So if you talk on Telegram, the messages get synced with the IRC channel, the related IRC channel. So Ovidiu from the Kubuntu project was running a tele-IRC bridge for the KDE Summer of Code project. So we just took over that infrastructure. We used tele-IRC is written in Node.js. It's a terrible idea for a lot of reasons. It ends up using, I think, 30% of our server's RAM, but it works. So if it works, we're happy. So I mean, we have infrastructure, we have capacity, so we don't have to worry about resource usage now, thankfully. So it works. So yeah, so we mirror a lot of channels. We use we mirror 10 KDE channels. You guys are here. You've been talking on the Academy and the Qtcon Telegram groups. They're all synced to the Hash Academy and Hash Qtcon Telegram IRC channels. So 10 KDE channels, 2 Wiki2Learn channels, and 5 Kubuntu channels. And if you want to have your channel and your project's Telegram group synced, all you need to do is file a sysadmin ticket on Fabricator, and we'll get it done. Or if you have rights to access the sysadmin IRC notifications.git repository yourself, it's just a JSON file, so it's self-explanatory. Just make the push, and every 10 minutes, the service tries to check this repository for new changes. If there is a change, it'll pull in, restart itself, and the new, and you're done. Right, Propagator. The KDE is first, server software. So yeah, so we have broadly 5 different types of repositories that we handle. We have project mainline project repositories. We have Scratch repositories, which people use to run their, experiment with code or keep their personal files around. We have personal clones, which are just clones of project repositories on their own account. So you can clone a repository wholesale and not worry about breaking other people's workflows. Websites are also stored in Git repositories. Also, although some repositories are still, some websites are still stored in Subversion, but a whole bunch of websites are stored in Git, and sysadmin stores all their repos in Git. So, and we have a single server running git.kde.org and 4 servers running anon git mirrors, but only 2 of them serve publicly. Git, Quick Git, and Review Board backups, they look it up from a private anon git mirror at Mimi, and Chili Project doesn't exist anymore. Fabricator pulls from projects.kde.org, which itself is a private anon git mirror. That last line will go away now because Fabricator will end up running on git.kde.org, so we'll be down to 3 servers. We have a read-only GitHub mirror, and the hardware, all this hardware is either in Germany or Switzerland, or Ericid is in San Francisco. This is the scale of our operations as on March 2016. I'll admit that I didn't look at new numbers for this. I just copied this slide over from my presentation at conf.kde.in, which is why the numbers are from March 2016. But yeah, so the number of repositories changed by plus minus 10 during that time. So yeah, 2,218 repositories, of which 745 are mainline repositories. So those 745 repositories have to be synced with GitHub, and the rest are scratches, clones, and sysadmin. So about 100,000 commits a year ish. We had 99,388. Commits the last year. It hovers from 95,000 to 120,000 thereabouts. And this number is only for projects, sysadmin, and Scratch, so not for websites, not for personal clones, etc. So the real number may be a bit bigger. And so we use Identity's LDAP database to store SSH keys, and then GitLite to pull those keys in and define access control rules, and have pretty URLs and quick Git for repo views. So this ties in. So how do we sync repos? So someone does a Git commit to git.kd.org, and we have custom hooks running on git.kd.org that notifies every Anon Git server via HTTP API. So every Anon Git server currently has a small daemon, HTTP daemon, written in Ruby that's just listening in, and we make a call to that particular endpoint, and then that Anon Git runs a Git pull to pull things in on their side. Unfortunately, this does not work for GitHub, because changes, we don't have any control over the server infrastructure at GitHub, so we'll have to push changes the normal way, with all the filtering and things. And we don't know if a sync failed, although this has saved us in the past, because in 2013, we almost lost all our repositories because of a disk crash in one of our servers. Apparently, the thing that rescued us was that we found an Anon Git mirror that had not been syncing for a while, so it had a pristine copy of the repositories around, and we were able to recover from that. But yeah, in general, we don't know if a sync has failed. So, and why are we using HTTP when we have SSH? It's a more secure way of doing things. It's encrypted. So yeah, the solution here is that git.kd.org pushes to both Anon Gits and GitHub. So we have the same thing happening for both types of remotes. So we just do a plain Git push mirror to the Anon Git servers, and we do the whole filtering thing, and then we find out which refs we want to push, and then we manually push those refs to GitHub. The smarter solution here is to have a long-running daemon on git.kd.org that logs failed pushes and retries them periodically with increasing backoffs. So if it fails, it tries 5 minutes later, then 15 minutes later, and then 30 minutes later, and if it doesn't work, it fails, and then notifies the sysadmins with an email or something that this isn't working, you should probably go take a look. And because we have this data available, we could probably have a pretty web server status web page that people can just look at and find out whether a particular server is live and syncing currently or not. And to achieve that, I have been working on a project called Propagator. It's written in Python, and it's Propagator is probably KDE's first server software project. So what is it? It's written in Python 3.5 and Pika. Pika is a tool that uses Pika is a library. It's a pure Python implementation of the AMQP protocol, and that ties in with RabbitMQ, which is the server that we use to handle our queues. And Circus is the, we had a choice between SupervisorD and Circus. I found Circus easier to configure, so I just use Circus for sub-process pool management. And there's a library called GitPython that ties in libgit and Python together, so that's how we manage, that's how we tap into the repository with Python. And this is a broad overview of how this works. So Git hooks on git.kd.org runs a script. That script sends a message to an AMQP exchange. So I'm going to explain how this works. So AMQP has a concept of exchanges and queues. So you send a message to an exchange. A whole bunch of queues are connected to that exchange. And the exchange will automatically fan out that message to all of the queues. So it's basically like a publish-subscribe system. You publish a message to a exchange. Anyone who's interested in that in those messages subscribes to the exchange by creating a queue that's hooked to that exchange. And so this is how it works. So suppose we have two types of upstreams, Anon Git and GitHub. And we have four workers for each type of upstream. So that's eight workers in total. So the four Anon Git workers share a common queue. And the four, so there'll be two queues, one for each type of upstream. And all the four Anon Git workers are listening in on the Anon Git queue, and the four GitHub workers are listening in on the GitHub queue. And the AMQP fanout exchange will deliver the message to both the Anon Git queue and the GitHub queue. And one of the workers subscribed to the, so only one of the four workers listening in on that queue will be able to dequeue the message. So there's no duplication per remote type. So only one Anon Git worker gets the message, only one GitHub server gets the message, but both types of workers get the message. And so this, the workers are just sent messages that this repository has been updated. So they can end up doing completely different things, not just sync repos. They can have custom tasks, custom shell scripts that will run per repo. They can have CI can be configured to be triggered from this instead of the one massive script that we have right now. We can have things that mirror that that work somewhat like GitHub's webhooks. We can probably have a website where you can actually create your own webhooks and do funny things with when repositories are synced, updated, and so on. And plans for Propagator, we roll out concurrently with Fabricator. So probably in, so Fabricator is built in, Propagator is actually built in two parts. There's one part that's running on git.kd.org, and there's one part that is running on the Anon Git server itself, which is accepting the pushes and creating the repositories if they're not already created on the Anon Git, and then accepting the pushes. So we are already using the part that's meant for the Anon Git part in our new San Francisco server edit, and it seems to be working fine. The server part, we are going to roll out concurrently with Fabricator, so probably going to happen in a month or so. So, and long term, when we have time, we'll probably try and build that dashboard web UI. Typo there, sorry. I'll fix that. I actually made this slide today morning, so. And I didn't have enough coffee before doing this. Sorry. Yeah. And this brings us to the final part of our presentation, new sponsors. So sometime earlier in the beginning of this year, CDN77.com actually contacted us offering CDN services. We already use Incapsula for CDN, but then we figured out that CDN77 and Incapsula are different enough in their design, their API, and so on and so forth, that we could actually make use of both. So we have been using CDN77 to serve static content on a bunch of websites, including KD.org, even Krita. And Krita, every time, apparently Krita is one of our most popular apps. Every time it has a new release, the load numbers are huge. So CDN77 has actually been able to, we didn't have to provision additional servers on our own infrastructure to handle the additional load created by a Krita release. CDN77 had completely absorbed it. The second big sponsor that has joined us is DigitalOcean. So this time we asked DigitalOcean for sponsorships because DigitalOcean's droplets are like perfectly sized. They're small enough to be dedicated to one task, one isolated task, and we actually wanted that, something like that. So we asked DigitalOcean to sponsor us. They have a program for sponsoring open source software projects with hosting and related things. So we asked us, and they very enthusiastically agreed to doing it. And then just a month after they agreed to sponsoring us, they started this new service called Block Storage, where you can just add additional hard drive storage to these droplets, because droplets only have 40 or 50 GB of hard drive space. And you can add block storage to these droplets. So this works really well for us. We are currently using it for hosting mirrors for SVN and Git, only in the US, because locations are limited to block storage areas, and block storage is only available in the US, in San Francisco, in one of the two data centers at San Francisco, and one at New York. Yeah?
They have it in Amsterdam.
Oh, right. So this must have happened really recently. Yeah. So they asked us. We have been having active dialogue with them, and they asked us how it's working for us. And we basically told them that we are limited by your block storage locations. We want one in Europe and one in the Asia Pacific to server Asia Pacific users. So now Amsterdam has worked out. So we'll probably be spinning up a mirror there. And. Hopefully, we'll have one either in Bangalore or Singapore, so we'll have one server to serve the massive KDE India community. So that's going to work out. And that's it. Questions?
Questions? Who has a question?
Olivier.
I have a question related to the all the project structure that we have everywhere, because it seems there is this one project XML. We use another one in it for the API. There is another one for AdStream, I think.
Yeah.
Is there a way to have just all the information either in the repo or somewhere so that we don't duplicate so much information?
That has been one of our plans. I've been trying to get all of this integrated into one place, but then apparently it appears that it's easier for the people to manage their own AppStream data in their own repositories, and it's easier for us to manage our sysadmin data in one consolidated place in a sysadmin repository. So so this has to be worked out. We have to find a way to not duplicate data anymore. But currently, we're still looking for ideas on how to do that. Probably one of the things that we may end up doing, this may be slightly orthogonal to your question, but we have a path describing where the repository, where the project resides. So it's like KDE graphics / spectacle. We may change that to have, so all projects just have a flat category. There's no path anymore. We just change the paths to a category or tags or something. That's how blogs would work. So yeah.
More questions? I do have a question.
Yeah.
You mentioned you were going to remove the Etherpad thingy.
Yeah.
I find it very useful.
Yeah. So the problem with Etherpad has been that it just crashes way too often. Again, another Node.js application. It's doing funny things. And people have been, because it crashes so much, we have had people just end up using, just get infuriated with it and end up using OwnCloud's documents. So, I mean, people themselves are trying to switch to OwnCloud documents. It's not us pushing them to. So, if we see that enough people have, we've seen that enough people have moved to open OwnCloud documents that we think it's probably not worth the additional effort on our side to keep Etherpad going.
Are there any plans to migrate the wiki to Fabricator as well?
Probably not, because MediaWiki is built for wikis, and we use the advanced features in MediaWiki. So Fabricator it's just not advanced enough as a wiki tool for us to be using it. So that's why we're going to keep MediaWiki around.
What about scratches and personal clones? Are they also migrated to Fabricator?
Yeah, this is why we are going to need community admins, because personal clones, and we may not have personal clones anymore, but scratches at the very least, you don't need approval from sysadmin to create a scratch repo. So we'll need to have community admins who will just have the rights to be able to create those repos for you. We basically want everything on Fabricator so that you guys can get to use the code review features and the repo browser and everything. So it just makes sense for everything to be there. Yeah, Martin had a question, I think. Martin Graceland.
That was mostly to the Node thing, because we mostly use it to collaboratively write, like really write at the same time. And Etherpad.
I think OwnCloud documents allows you to do that simultaneously. But I mean, really, we want comments. If you think that if it's worth the trouble of keeping it around, you should just come and tell us.
We can try it, but it's just I wanted to be sure that. That collaborative aspect.
Yeah, the collaborative aspect
real time
is there.
At the same time writing.
Yeah, yeah. It is there. I mean, just have a look, see if it works well for you.
Any more questions? Okay, no more questions. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.